الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم توفنا مسلمين والحقنا بالصالحين اللهم آمين أما بعد عن أبي مالك الحارث بن عاصم الأشعري رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الطهور شطر الإيمان والحمد لله تملأ الميزان وسبحان الله والحمد لله تملأان أو تملأ ما بين السماء والأرض. This is the first part of the hadith that we are, which is hadith number 23 in al-Ahadith al-Nawawiyyah, the 42 Nawawi hadith narrated by Muslim. This hadith is one amazing, incredible hadith that the statements in this hadith just pierce through the heart and compel anyone that has any level of iman to adhere to this hadith and to apply it and to understand it in details and to follow the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, as he gives us the best of advice and the best of wasaya in this hadith. So here in this part, in the first part of this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, "At-tuhuru shatrul iman." Tuhur is different from tahur. The word tahur, it means, refers to that which we use to perform our ablution or our ghusl, like water or the water substitute in absence of the water. The word tuhur is to purify oneself. The scholars have two different interpretations in that. Is to purify oneself from all forms of najasa, impurities, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the Prophet ﷺ by saying, وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهِّرْ, and your garments purify. Purified from the najasa, purified from any impurities by performing the wudu or the ghusl and purifying your look and your garments before performing the ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It also means to purify oneself from intangible matters like committing the kaba'ir, al-fahisha, you know, sins. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the people of Lut, Prophet Lot alayhi salam, and he said, إِنَّهُمْ إِنَاسٌ أُنَاسٌ يَتَطَهَّرُونَ أَخْرِجُوا آلَ لُوطٍ مِّن قَرْيَتِكُمْ إِنَّهُمْ أُنَاسٌ يَتَطَهَّرُونَ. Expel the people of Lot alayhi salam from your qariya, from your town. إِنَّهُمْ أُنَاسٌ يَتَطَهَّرُونَ. They are people that are purifying themselves from the fahisha, which is homosexuality. And that's the fahisha, the grave sin, the big sin that the people of Lot have committed. So here, another group of the scholars said, means that to purify oneself from evil acts, from sins, from big sins, from small sins. So the first part refers to purifying one's garment from impurities. The second interpretation, which is also mentioned in the Quran, purify oneself from all acts of prohibition. All acts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made prohibited and has associated with this sin or with this act a punishment in this dunya or in the hereafter. إِنَّهُمْ أُنَاسٌ يَتَطَهَّرُونَ الطُّهُورُ شَطْرُ الْإِيمَانِ. It also refers to the salah, because iman has been interpreted in the Quran to mean, we know that at the outset of the message, before the Prophet ﷺ was taken on a journey by night and received the five obligatory daily prayers, that the Muslims used to pray. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala summoned the Prophet ﷺ to give him that heavy task, that honorable task, which is the five daily prayers, that salah, that connection between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wherein we are invoking praise and supplications. And as in the hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نُصْفَيْنِ, that I've divided this salah between me and my abdi into two parts. To make this hadith, or to sum up this hadith, is that this is a dialogue between the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself, meaning that there are no intermediaries, there are no agents in between. So therefore, it's such an honorable act. And in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, As-salatu imadu al-deen. Man aqamaha faqad aqama al-deen, wa man hadamaha faqad hadama al-deen. So this salah, this salah, this connection between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not merely an exercise. It's a spiritual experience, it's a physical experience, it's an interaction between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as the son of Abu Sufyan used to say, radiallahu anhu, he used to say that if you wish to have a dialogue with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, establish the salah. And if you wish for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to speak to you, read the Quran, recite the Quran. So you can see in this salah, we have a dialogue with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We bow down to Him. In this salah, we come to the closest position that we can come to with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we are in a state of sujood. And similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made this salah a criterion for success. As He says in Surah Al-Mu'minun, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Indeed, the believers are successful, those who achieve khushu', meaning that those who are focused on the recitation, the understanding of the Qur'an. When they say Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, they mean what they say. And we're going to come, inshallah, in the second and third sentence in this hadith and explain what the tasbih means and when is it due. And what the hamd means, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins with alhamd in Surah Al-Fatiha that we recite in every rak'ah in our salah, what does that mean and the places where we ought to invoke hamd, praise, you know, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we can see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. So in the ayat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to the salah, where الطهور شطر الإيمان. Tahur means it's half of Iman. Iman here has been also interpreted to mean Salah. Where is the evidence? The evidence in the Quran. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِالنَّاسِ لَرَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to waste your Iman. Means that after the command for the change of the Qibla from Bayt al-Maqdis to Mecca, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Sahaba, you know, asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what about those who prayed before us and they passed away before the Qibla changed? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِالنَّاسِ لَرَوْفٌ رَحِيمٌ. That whatever they've done in submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in obedience to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whether prayed towards Bayt al-Maqdis or prayed towards Mecca, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not waste that, because the ibrah, the wisdom, is in following the command of the legislator and on his behalf, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is the ibrah. And he says, also confirming that in the Quran, لَيْسَ الْبِرُّ أَن تُوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ قِبَلَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ. It is not birr that you turn your faces to the east or to the west. Birr is who believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do all these wonderful acts of worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded in this long ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah. So at-tahuru shatrul iman in this case means tahur, purifying one's garments and oneself in order to prepare themselves for iman, and in this case meaning that salah is half of the salah, because as we know, salah is not acceptable without wudu, without ghusl, or in general without tahara, because sometimes the najasa requires ghusl or requires, you know, wudu. And we all understand when it requires ghusl and when it requires wudu. At-tahuru shatrul iman walhamdulillahi tamla'ul mizan. Alhamdulillah, saying Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. And as we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one and the only one that's worthy of all of the hamd. Before He even brought His creation into existence. And that's why we see in Surah Al-Fatiha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala began by praising Himself, saying Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, and did not wait for us to praise Himself. And Alhamd here with the Alif Lam, the definite article, means all of the hamd, not part of it. All of the hamd, before He brought this creation into existence, and before and after bringing this creation into existence. So there are five places that the scholars teach us that hamd is necessary. When we say Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, that will bring that into our minds and our hearts. The first place is that Alhamdulillahi ala rububiyyati. The Alhamdulillah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Rabb. And as we know, the Rabb is the one who brought everything and everyone into existence, is the one who tends to the affairs of His creation, is the one who sustains the heavens and the earth and all that's in between, is the one who bestows the rizq upon His, people, is the one who gives them shifa, is the one who gives them healing, is the one who gives them everything they need. This is the function of Ar-Rabb, and none gives that but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is Ar-Rabb. So when we think of Ar-Rububiyyah, when we think of Ar-Rabb, the cherisher, the sustainer, the maintainer, we think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. The second place is Tawheed, in Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one and the only one, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is rightfully worshipped. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has earned this sole right to be worshipped, or to be worshipped solely from the fact that He is the only Rabb. And he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, did not take yani a son, did not take a daughter, did not take anyone in between us. So therefore our worship to him is direct. And we praise him for that he allowed us to worship him directly without any agents, without anyone in between us. Thirdly, we invoke hamd to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the legislation that he legislated for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the heavens and the earth and has descended the revelations by way of the wahi Jibreel alayhi salam upon 124,000 prophets and messengers throughout the history of mankind. And this was perfected with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And as he says, Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitaba wa lam yaj'al lahu iwaja. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is praising himself again, because he's the only one who can rightfully and dutifully and fully praise himself. We are way too, imperfect and too, short change, if you will, in our creation to invoke praise that is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here he's praising himself that he has descended this book, the Qur'an. إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمُ. The one that guides to the best of the best. The one that concluded all revelations. The one that came upon the hands or with the hands of the master of the children of Adam. The one whose character was the Qur'an. And that is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ عِوَجَى. There is no crookedness. There's nothing to be criticized. There's nothing to be critiqued about the Qur'an, so it's perfect in every possible way. It's a complete system of guidance in every possible way. So we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the fact that he descended this complete curriculum, if you will, of guidance. As he says, مَا فَرَّطْنَا فِي الْكِتَابِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. Without leaving anything that we as people need to achieve our happiness in this dunya or in the hereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made this book the perfection for all prior revelations. And of course, if we think of the legislation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every time we learn something about our deen, we say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, because when we learn that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. He did not make this deen difficult for you to practice. So we say Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has perfected this Qur'an. We say Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated salah in this Qur'an. We say Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So every time, and that's why the people of knowledge are the ones who are truly invoking the praise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the best of their ability, because every time they learn a rule in the Sharia, every time they learn ayah, every time they learn about the wisdom behind the legislation of an obligatory act of worship or an afila, or the prohibition of an act that is bad for us, a sin or a fahija, they say Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah. So the thirdly is that we say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen for the legislation that he has legislated for us, and for the perfection and for the rewards that we reap as a result of this legislation in this dunya and in the hereafter. Thirdly, we say Alhamdulillah ala al-qada'i wal-qadr. Pay attention to this one. The scholars also say Alhamdulillah ala al-qada' wal-qadr, but their hamd is different from the average person. When we are afflicted by a calamity, we say Alhamdulillah, or sometimes we make a statement that we shouldn't make. We say Alhamdulillah alladhi la yuhmadu ala makruhin suwa. Alhamdulillah that none is praised for that which we dislike, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The scholars interpret that to be an objection or lack of patience upon that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destined for us prior to the creation of the heavens and the earth with 50,000 years. And in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says what? He said, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ أو عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلُّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٍ. The ones who truly understand the statement are the scholars. It's amazing the situation of the believer, all of his affairs, all of his matters, in it there's khayr, there's good. So when the scholars learn this, and they learn that إِذَا حَبَّ اللَّهُ الْعَبْدِ ابْتَلَاهُ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves his slave, he will put him to test. He will put her to test in their family, in themselves, in their health, in their wealth. Of course, internally, the human nature doesn't like that. The human nature, that's a fact, internally, we don't like that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us with our wealth. And the wealth is what is very close to our hearts and our souls. So we don't like to be tested with that. But the scholars understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not test them with that, except because He loves them and He wants to bring them closer. Because in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُ سَرَّاءَ شَكَرْ كَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ. If something good touches this believer, shakar, he is busy giving the shukr for the ni'mah. He is busy giving the shukr for the ni'mah. And of course, very few of us who truly give shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He says in the Quran, وَقَلِيلٌ مِّنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورُ. A few, or not so many, of my devotees are truly grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you see that the scholars are busy giving the shukr. وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ ضَرَّاءَ الصَّبَرُ. إِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ ضَرَّاءَ الصَّبَرُ. If harm or calamity touches him in his health, in his wealth, in his in his family, then he is patient. So the scholars truly understand that persevering upon al-qada' or al-qadr, predestination and preordination, is a tremendous bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is a tremendous bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's why we ought to persevere in patience upon that, and they feel closer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the extent that the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when they were not tested for a while in their health or in their wealth or in their families, they became very concerned, thinking that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cares not about them. So for the ammi, for the average person, of course, for those who are truly believers, but still they did not have the share of knowledge that the scholars have received, they will make the statement that all praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that none is dutifully praised for that which we dislike except Him. So the scholars said that statement should not be made. Even though internally we may have these negative feelings or these feelings of sorrow or unhappiness, if you will, for the loss that we've sustained, but we should not verbalize that. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not hold us responsible for what we feel inside. But He holds us responsible for what we utter. For what we utter. Because uttering these words is a form of objection to predestination and preordination. And we as believers, we believe in predestination and preordination without any objection whatsoever. We believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has destined the best of everything for us to test us in this dunya. And He tells us the wisdom in Surah Al-Hadeeth, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا أَصَابَ مِنْ مُصِيبَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مِّنْ قَبْلِ أَن نَبْرَأَهَا إِنَّ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرٌ لِكَيْ لَا تَأْسَوْا عَلَى مَا فَاتَكُمْ وَلَا تَفْرَحُوا بِمَا آتَاكُمْ وَاللَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ كُلَّ مُخْتَالٍ فَخُورٍ. So whatever calamity or something good that has touched you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is already in the preserved tablet. مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ نَبْرَأَهَا, before it descends upon you. And the wisdom behind that, لِكَيْ لَا تَأْسَوْا عَلَى مَا فَاتَكُمْ, so you don't feel overly, desperate and feeling sorrow over the loss. When you come to know that it has been destined, it's been written in the preserved tablet, and this is the time and place for it to descend. وَلَا تَفْرَحُوا بِمَا آتَاكُمْ, and so you do not become overjoyed with that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you, and you do not attribute it to yourself, denying the source of the bounty, just like Qarun said, إِنَّمَا أُتِيتُهُ عَلَى عِلْمٍ عَنْدِي. So there's tremendous, I was given this because of knowledge that he possessed. That's his claim, and it's a false one, of course. So the wisdom is already, made to us. So believing in predestination and preordination is part of the pillars of Iman, which each and every one of us is obligated to believe in. And in the hadith, one of the Sahaba was given this advice to his son, O my son, you will never taste the sweetness of Iman until you come to know the certainty of knowledge that whatever has afflicted you was meant for you. And whatever has missed you has also been, meant or destined to miss you. Ya Bunay, then he says, O my son, I indeed have heard the Prophet ﷺ saying that whoever dies believing anything contrary to that, he is not one of my ummah. He is not one of my ummah. So we can see all these places of hamd that we can think of when we say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, and we understand what that means. Walhamdulillahi tamla'ul mizan. And as we know, the deeds that we perform are weighed on Judgment Day. The statements that we perform are weighed on Judgment Day. The deeds of the heart on Judgment Day are also weighed. So saying Alhamdulillah is weighed on Judgment Day. Tamla'ul mizan means that after everything has been weighed, this hamd comes to fill this scale of hasanat. And of course, we do not go into quantifying, you know how much hasanat we reap as a result of saying alhamd, or because it's a matter of al-ghayb. So matters of al-ghayb, when they are mentioned in the Quran, we believe in them and we accept them at their face value without trying to go into the intricate details or to quantify what's being said here. Walhamdulillahi tamla al-mizan wa subhanallahi walhamdulillahi tamla'ani aw tamla'u ma bayna as-sama'i wal-ard. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the third sentence, and this will be the last part of the hadith inshallah for tonight, wa subhanallah. Subhanallah is different from alhamdulillah, but the two go together. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, kalimatani khafifatani 'ala al-lisan thaqilatani fil mizan habibatani lir-rahman. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi subhanallah al-'azim. Kalimatan here means two statements. Khafifatani 'ala al-lisan means that anyone, it doesn't matter what their native tongue is, can say these words. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi subhanallah al-'azim. So khafifatani 'ala al-lisan, they're very light for the tongue. Thaqilatani fil mizan, they are very heavy in our scales of hasanat. حبيبتان للرحمن, they are most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahman, the all gracious. Subhanallah wa bihamdi subhanallah al-azim. The word subhanallah requires tanzih, negation. The word alhamdulillah requires affirmation. So we mentioned that alhamd is due when it comes to tawheed al-rububiyyah, tawheed al-uluhiyyah, tawheed al-asma' wa-sifat. We actually did not touch upon that, but when it comes to saying alhamdulillah for al-asma' wa-sifat, means that no matter what we think of the asma', the names, the divine names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how beautiful they are, how perfect they are, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is way above that. And that's where the name Quddus comes into the picture. That no matter how much we praise and we elevate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are too deficient to elevate Him as He ought to be elevated. To praise Him as He ought to be praised, and that's where the name Al-Quddus comes in, meaning that He's way above that. But we are still commanded to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So subhanallah is to negate anything that's inappropriate to be attributed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to Ar-Rububiyyah. Means that we do not associate any partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do not raise our hands to anyone but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to realizing that He's the creator and He's the sustainer and He's the one who bestows the bounties and He's the one who bestows the rizq and He's the one who grants the shifa. So we do not, commit shirk in that respect. We also do not commit shirk, which is tanzih, when it comes to al-uluhiyyah. We do not say that He's one of the three. We do not say that He has helpers. We do not say that He's in, He's in need of His own throne, the one that He created and He's presided upon it. And by the way, presiding upon the throne is a matter of al-ghayb, but the scholars also allude to our attention that there is no touching. In other words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is independent of the throne, and the throne is created, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above His creation. So when it comes to al-uluhiyyah, we take Him as an ilah. We direct all acts of worship towards Him and nobody else without committing any shirk or riya. Be it the big shirk when it comes to believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His divine names and attributes, and the six pillars of iman, or the riya when it comes to the actionable items that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to worship Him with. So in other words, we do not commit shirk in al-uluhiyyah. And we always rely upon Him, haqq al-tawakkul, knowing that He's the one and the only one that sustains everyone and everything. أَلَا لَهُ الْخَلْقُ وَالْأَمْرُ, to Him belongs the creation, and to Him belong the execution of all matters. So therefore we do not direct our needs to anyone else but Him, and we put our full trust in Him and our full reliance upon Him, knowing that none can bring us harm except with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And none can do us good or benefit us in any way except with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the word tasbih when it comes to rububiyyah, uluhiyyah, al-asma' wa-sifat. So we ought to understand these asma', these divine names and attributes, and we ought to worship Him with every name. So worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the name ar-Razzaq. We do not seek sustenance from anyone but Him. We do not perceive anyone to be the one who is the provider for us but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or everybody else on the face of the earth, they're just means for us to receive our sustenance. Similarly, when we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Qawi, He's the All-Powerful, the Almighty, we do not fear anyone else more than we fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Kareem, the All-Generous,
Means that whatever bounties we are indulgent in, it's from him. And we emulate and worship in that name. And we emulate in the sense that we also become generous. في سبيل الله. Put in our true trust and our true devotion, our true, you know, dependence and reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When it comes to tasbih, with respect to the sharia that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated for us, we think of the Qur'an as the perfect Qur'an. We do not advance our opinions and our statements in front of the statements of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the ahadith of the Prophet. We do not speak in the ayat or the ahadith, the ayat of the Qur'an or the hadith of the Prophet without knowledge. There's no speculation, there's no guessing. We do not think when we fail to understand because of our ignorance or inability to comprehend, we do not say that there's a problem with the ayah or there's a problem with this ruling or why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't even ask the question why when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but we try to grasp on the wisdom. What is the wisdom behind this? What is the wisdom behind that? So we believe that the legislation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is perfect in every possible way. Again, when we speak about predestination and ordination, we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His statements, His actions, everything that He does is out of infinite knowledge and wisdom. So we do not question, you know, predestination and preordination. You will even hear sometimes Muslims saying, why do bad things happen to good people? Subhanallah, it's qada wa qadar. This is what we believe in, predestination, preordination. So these statements should never come out of the mouth of a believer, one who believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judgment day. We accept that whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed is according to His infinite knowledge and wisdom, and we accept it by saying, أَنَا رَاضٍ بِكُلِّ مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لِي وَمُسْجِلِ إِلَيْهِ حَمْدًا جَزِيلًا فَالرِّضَى آيَةُ الْبَرَاءَةِ وَالْإِيمَانُ بِاللَّهِ نَاصِرًا وَوَكِيلًا وَالرِّضَى نِعْمَةٌ مِنَ اللَّهِ لَمْ يُسْعِدْ بِهَا فِي الْعِبَادِ إِلَّا الْقَلِيلًا. I am content and happy with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed, and I praise Him for that, just like the scholars do. Because being content and pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a ni'mah that not everybody is enjoying. So being content with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one of the biggest ni'mah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He sent the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, excuse me, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel alayhi salam, delivering a message to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet ﷺ is delivering a message to Abu Bakr. So the Prophet ﷺ says, "Inna Allah yuqri'uka as-salam." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you, "Assalamu alaykum." Wa yaqulu lak, and He's telling you that He is pleased with you. Imagine Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sending the messenger of the heavens to the messenger of the earth to deliver a message to Abu Bakr to tell him that He is pleased with him. And then the rhetorical question comes, which is more amazing. فَهَلْ أَنْتَ رَاضٍ عَنْهُ. Are you pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Of course, you know, Abu Bakr could not help but to break down crying. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sending him this message in honor of Abu Bakr. So being content with al-qada' wal-qadr is part of being a true believer, one with deep conviction in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala executes in terms of orders, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislates, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees for us, is the best for us. Subhanallah walhamdulillah. So the two go together. We negate anything that is inappropriate to be attributed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these five items. And then we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by saying alhamdulillah also for the perfection of these five items. And in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, tamla'ani aw tamla'u ma bayna as-sama'i wal-ard. It fills up in terms of hasanat, but between the heavens and the earth. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا يُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُمْ. Everything in existence is in constant tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, we do not understand the language of animals, inanimate objects, or anything else except the language that we speak, you know, as people. So in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, also the most dua that he used in his salah, saying, سُبُّوحٌ قُدُّوسٌ رَبُّ الْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالرُّوحِ. Subuh means kathir al-tasbih. Frequently, everything and everyone is in constant tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Quddus means way above this tasbih and way above the praise. Rabbul malakit wa ruh, the Lord of the angels and Jibreel alayhi salam. With this, inshallah, we'll conclude this first part of the hadith, inshallah, and we'll resume, inshallah, next Sunday with the second part.
أقول قولي هذا واستغفروه سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.